We can have a question. But examiners and chairs don't ask questions in the public part, but everyone else can do. And yeah, the important point is it is not allowed to take any pictures and to record. So please turn off this recording device. And can you show me the title? So she, Margaret, is going to talk about her thesis work entitled Characterization of Acantharea-Phaeocystis Photosymbioses Distribution, Abundance, Maintenance, and Host Control. You ready? Yeah, please begin.
Okay. So, welcome everybody. Thank you so much for coming to my thesis defense from all different places and time zones. This afternoon, or this evening, or this morning, I will be talking about my thesis, the characterization of Acantharea-Phaeocystis photosymbioses, distribution, abundance, specificity, and maintenance, and host control. So to get started, Acantharians belong to the supergroup Rhizaria, which also includes foraminifera and radiolaria. Most of these organisms have biomineralized skeletons, and all of them are single-celled microbial eukaryotes or protists. So the foraminifera have calcium carbonate skeletons, the radiolaria have silica skeletons, and the acantharians have strontium sulfate skeletons. And another common trait among these organisms is that many of them host algal symbionts, therefore participating in photosymbiosis. Photosymbiosis is probably best known for the role that it plays in coral reef ecosystems. Reef-building corals host endosymbiotic microalgae, which allows them to be very productive in low-nutrient coastal regions, and ultimately lets them support some of the most productive and biodiverse marine ecosystems on Earth. Similarly, photosymbioses between rhizarians and endosymbiotic microalgae allows rhizarians to be very productive in low-nutrient regions out in the open ocean. Really emphasizing this, it's been shown that rhizarians can enrich photosynthesis in oligotrophic waters by several orders of magnitude. So for example, a single acantharian could fix 22,000 times more carbon than an equivalent volume of oligotrophic seawater. In addition, this primary production can support very active microhabitats. So large photosynthetic cells, like this diatom here on the right, but also like photosymbiotic rhizarians, can attract a large amount of bacterial activity, which is really highlighted in this image here. And all of this bacterial activity can then be transferred into the microbial food web. Now, among rhizarians, and really among all organisms, acantharians are unique because they biomineralize strontium sulfate. And strontium sulfate is very heavy. It has a specific gravity of 3.8 compared to calcium carbonate's 2.7 and silica's 2.6. These strontium skeletons can cause acantharians to sink very quickly. And when you combine this with their relatively large size, they're a lot bigger than cyanobacteria and pico eukaryotes that are more abundant. This fast sinking rate can mean that acantharians disproportionately contribute to carbon export in oligotrophic systems. But these skeletons can also be problematic if you're trying to study acantharians, because these strontium sulfate skeletons dissolve in many common fixatives that are used with plankton samples. So for example, this acantharian is shown here on the left shortly after it was collected. And then after 6 hours being in a 5% formalin seawater solution, the spines have almost completely dissolved. And in fact, almost all acantharians will dissolve in 12 to 24 hours when they're stored in 5% formalin, with the caveat that if there's enough acantharians in the sample, then as those acantharians dissolve, they can saturate the sample and keep further acantharians from disintegrating. But as a result, early plankton surveys underestimated the abundance of acantharians by an order of magnitude. It was not until the 80s and 90s when researchers accounted for these sampling issues by adding strontium sulfate to plankton samples and also using Niskin bottles alongside plankton pumps instead of just nets, when the abundance of acantharians was really appreciated. So these studies found that acantharians were on average at a concentration of 1.6 to 7.5 cells per liter, but they actually found them at maximum values of 30 to 40 cells per liter. However, this type of sampling and cell counting is actually quite tedious and time-consuming, so these types of studies haven't been repeated more recently, especially since molecular methods have become easier and less expensive and therefore much more common. So in this molecular age, acantharians continue to be well represented in samples collected throughout the global ocean from the surface all the way down to deep water. And this is just a sampling of the studies that have reported this result. So, if anybody needed convincing, I hope that I've convinced you that acantharian photosymbioses are an ecologically significant system. They are abundant large photosynthesizers in low nutrient surface waters, making them productivity hotspots. Their unique morphology contributes to carbon exports, and they're found at least in some form throughout the water column, even into very deep water. But acantharian photosymbioses are not just ecologically significant, they're also significant in an evolutionary context, especially if we're interested in thinking about how organisms acquire chloroplasts. So looking at this acantharian cell on the left, the red indicates chlorophyll autofluorescence from the symbionts, and we can see that all of the symbionts are cloistered very tightly in the center of the cell in the inner cytoplasm. And we can compare this to a foraminifera, where the symbionts are distributed in different layers of cytoplasm and are even extended out onto these pseudopodial networks, demonstrating that the symbiosis in foraminifera is more fluid and flexible compared to the more fixed nature of the symbiosis in the acantharians. Furthermore, the acantharian symbionts undergo a large morphological change in symbiosis. So if we look at this symbiont highlighted in the white box on the bottom, it has two chloroplasts and is quite small. And we can compare that to the symbiont here in the upper right that is quite larger and has many more chloroplasts. And this is much more evident in this FibSEM imaging that was performed by Johann Dessel. You can see here on the left that this free-living symbiont just has those two chloroplasts and is on the smaller side. And then when it's living in symbiosis, it gets larger and has more chloroplasts. So in essence, we have extreme symbiont remodeling and symbiosis, which is really focused on enhancing photosynthetic machinery. So this strong integration of symbionts along with the morphological change might mean that acantharians are on the road towards acquiring plastids. And plastid acquisition is really fascinating because it's one of two examples where a host cell turned a bacterial cell into an organelle. And unlike mitochondria, which arose only one time and have not been lost or gained since, eukaryotes continue to gain and lose plastids throughout evolutionary history and into the current present. Plastid loss and acquisition is particularly common among the dinoflagellates, and these systems have been studied quite a bit. So if we look at the projection of symbiosis towards plastid acquisition, we can start on the left here with engulfment and endosymbiosis, followed by symbiont reduction and gene transfer to the host, and then finally we end up with an actual plastid. And most of the dinoflagellates that are in the process of acquiring plastids, not all of them, but most of them, are in this middle stage. But acantharians are actually more here. So their symbionts are being morphologically changed, but they haven't lost the ability to live outside of the host. So potentially, these acantharian photosymbioses might be a rather unique opportunity to study the very early stages of plastid acquisition and the underlying mechanisms of host control. So all of this has led me to ask a couple questions about acantharian biology. First, I'm interested in how abundant these acantharians are currently in low nutrient surface waters, because remember all of the studies that I cited before were performed in the 80s and 90s. And then I'm especially interested in how these cell counts compare to the genetic methods that are much more common nowadays. I'm also interested in how specific the symbiosis is, how are symbionts maintained, and whether or not symbionts are able to divide inside the host or if hosts digest symbionts. I'm also interested, finally, in how the acantharians manipulate symbiont populations. So probably unsurprisingly, these questions are grouped into three groups that end up making up the basis of my three thesis chapters. So the first chapter is looking at the acantharian abundance and water column distribution in the subtropical Western North Pacific. And this chapter has been submitted as a manuscript and is currently under review. The second chapter is looking at the specificity and maintenance of Acantharea-Phaeocystis photosymbioses, and this chapter was published in 2018 in Frontiers in Microbiology. And the third chapter is looking at nutrient exchange and host control in Acantharea-Phaeocystis photosymbioses, and this chapter is still being written up. So starting at the beginning with the first chapter, I was very interested in finding out exactly how abundant acantharians were in the water in the region where I live near Okinawa. So instead of deploying Niskin bottles and plankton pumps, I instead decided to use an in situ high throughput plankton imaging system. In particular, I used the ISIS small imager, which is made by Bellamar. And we attached this imaging system to the back of the Jamstack deep toe, which is a frame that we can attach a whole bunch of instruments, including more cameras and CTDs. And this frame was deployed on a cruise that we went on from Taiwan to the mainland of Japan. And each of the closed points that are near a station number are stations that we deployed the imaging frame and collected water samples for DNA. So stations 10, 3, 15, and 17 had both sampling methods. And then all of the stations I collected seawater samples for DNA. So we lowered this deep toe system straight down through the water column to 1,000 meters, and then it was pulled forward at 1,000 meters and continued forward momentum as it was pulled back up to the ship. And because the ISIS is actually at the back of this frame, we only are going to use the images from the downward cast, because if the imaging system is moving forward, it could interfere with water moving into the imaging area of the camera, and therefore the counts would not be quantitative. But even just using this downcast data, I still had 13,158 photos to look at, which is the equivalent of sampling 4,932 liters of water. So most of the photos look like this. This one is from near the surface. You can see there's lots of stuff going on in this image. And some of the photos that were taken closer to the 1,000 meter depth, there is not so much to look at. But you can see in the bottom left of this image, there is one acantharian. And by looking at all of these photos, I was able to identify 1,235 acantharian regions of interest. And these acantharians came in a wide variety of sizes and shapes. An added bonus of using this method is that I got to see acantharians in their natural state rather than being smashed up in a net. So I observed on multiple occasions acantharians with these strange drop-like structures, which, the best to my knowledge, we haven't seen things like this before. So I'm not sure exactly what it does, but it was a really fun thing to see. And in order to compare the images to DNA, I collected two replicates of 5 liters from two different Niskin bottles deployed at 4 depths at each station. And then I filtered those 5 liter replicates through two filter pore sizes, 10 micrometer filter pore size and 0.2 micrometer filter pore size, with the goal of having the vegetative cells or the reproductive or resting cysts be on the larger filter pore size, and then any reproductive cells, swimmer cells, or free living symbionts would go through and land on this smaller filter pore size. And then I sequenced the 18S V4 region, and I processed all of my sequences with data 2 to get exact sequence variants, and I classified all of those sequence variants using the protist ribosomal reference database. So looking first at the results from the imaging, I found that the mean surface values for acantharian cell concentrations were comparable in the western North Pacific to historical observations from near Bermuda and in the eastern North Pacific. So they ranged from a little over one to up to 4.5 cells per liter in the surface waters on our cruise. And this concentration decreased quite drastically with depth, although acantharians were still sporadically present in deep water. And finally, the acantharians were concentrated above the subsurface chlorophyll maximum, which could be indication that there's some niche partitioning. So if there is nutrient exchange inside of the acantharians, then they might be released from relying on nutrients from deeper water and can exist higher up in the water column where they can get more light. So next, comparing these results to the sequencing results, I looked at the percentage of acantharian sequences that were contributing to the overall sequencing libraries in each sample. And I found that the percentage of acantharian sequences increased with depth, which is the opposite of the relationship that I observed for the imaging results. So to look at this in a little bit more detail, I went down one taxonomic level. So in this plot, the bars are broken up by the depth for the samples were taken. So surface, subsurface chlorophyll maximum, middle water column, and near the bottom. And then they're broken up horizontally by the filter pore size. So the larger filter pore size on top and the smaller filter pore size on the bottom. Each bar represents the two replicates from that individual station, and the stations are ordered from south to north. And so looking at the actual colors inside of each bar, this dark blue color represents acantharian sequences that I couldn't classify any further than just being an acantharian. And then the light blue, the dark green, and the light green are groups of acantharians that are defined only by environmental sequences. So there's no type specimen associated with these sequences, and we don't know what these organisms look like. But these groups, the Tronacanthida and the Arthracanthida, Cynthiacanthida acantharians, are acantharians that their sequences correspond to actual type specimens. So we know what these organisms look like. And inherently, these are the organisms that I was probably counting since I know what they look like. So I wanted to see if these sequences better correlate with the images for these organisms. And we can see just by taking a quick look at the data that the relative abundance of these groups does look like it's decreasing as they go deeper into the water column. And when we do a linear regression, it does indeed decrease with depth. So these Tronacanthida, Arthracanthida, and Cynthiacanthida acantharians contribute less to the sequencing libraries from the deeper depths. And if I directly compare the percentage of these organisms with the number of cells per liter that I counted, I actually get a pretty decent correlation. So we can use this discrepancy between these organisms that we do know what they look like and the ones that we don't know what they look like to think more about what the ones that we don't know what they look like. So looking at the evolutionary trajectory of acantharians, the clades that diverged most recently down here on the bottom are the Arthracanthida and Cynthiacanthida acantharians. So these have the most robust skeletons. They're thick and strong, and they are fused at the center. So these spines cannot collapse. And then if we look at the clades that diverged further back in time, we see that the skeletons become less robust. And all the way up here, we have spines that don't fuse in the center of the skeleton. So these spines can actually collapse and fold up or be shedded. And then all the way at the basal portion of the tree, we have these unknown morphotypes, these environmental clades that we don't know what they look like. So if we follow this trajectory up towards these guys that we don't know what they look like, we can hypothesize that these might not have skeletons at all, or the skeletons might be a rudimentary, smaller skeleton than what we're used to seeing. And this actually corresponds to what we're seeing with the sequencing and the imaging, because we're having more and more sequences from these clades up here, but we're not counting any more cells as we get deeper into the water. So we're probably not counting these things that we don't know what they look like. And going forward, if we really do want to know what they look like, we might have to think a little bit outside the box and look for isolates that don't look like a traditional acantharian. So moving on to looking at the size, I also looked at the size of all of the cells that I counted, and I found that the size range decreases with depth. So at the very surface, we have a lot of small cells, but we also have some medium-sized cells and some very large cells. And as we get deeper down into the water, that range decreases, where most of the cells now are on the smaller side. And this actually corresponds really nicely with previous hypotheses that have been put forward regarding the acantharian life cycle. So it was previously hypothesized that acantharians can make cysts, and that these cysts help them get into deeper water where they can release their reproductive cells in relative safety, and then get bigger as they move back into the photic zone where there's more predators. And this corresponds really nicely with this size range, where we have smaller cells at the bottom that are getting larger as they move back up towards the surface. But you'll notice in this hypothesis also that it was previously hypothesized that these photosymbiotic acantharians probably stay in the surface because they rely on those symbionts and because they can't make cysts. But something that's really interesting about photosymbiotic acantharians is they actually have a much more developed cytoskeleton network, so they have very fine control of their buoyancy and can really nicely control where they are in the water column. And if we look at the sequencing results from this study, we can see that there's not a very big difference between the Chonacanthida acantharians, which are known to make cysts and are usually not symbiotic, and the Arthrocanthida symphyacanthida acantharians, which are photosymbiotic. If we look at their relative abundance in the middle water and the deep water, they're about the same, and that's true for both the large filter size and the smaller filter size. So this makes me think that maybe, potentially, these photosymbiotic acantharians might also take advantage of this cycling between the deep water and the shallow water, but instead of making cysts, they just rely on those very heavy skeletons that they have and their ability to control their buoyancy so that they can sink down and then come back up. So in summary for this chapter, I found that acantharian abundances in the Western North Pacific were comparable to historical observations in other regions. The cells were concentrated near the surface, and size range decreased with depth. The cell counts correlated with sequence abundance for acantharians with known morphology, but not for the acantharians without known morphology. And by combining omics with imaging, we can inform theories regarding morphology, behavior, and life history traits. So moving on to chapter two, looking at the specificity and maintenance of Acantharea-Phaeocystis photosymbioses. It's been shown previously by Dissel et al. And PNAS that Arthrocanthida and Symphyacanthida acantharians always host Phaeocystis endosymbionts. And this is really cool because Phaeocystis is a very interesting genus on its own. So Phaeocystis is a globally distributed haptophyte genus. It's a bloom-forming genus, and these blooms are sometimes considered nuisance or harmful blooms, but they're also a really important contributor to carbon and sulfur cycling in the ocean. And which Phaeocystis species is more likely to bloom or is most abundant is mostly dependent on the latitude. So in the northern hemisphere, at the higher latitudes, we see that Phaeocystis pushetti is most common. And then in the temperate latitudes in both hemispheres, Phaeocystis globosa is most common. And in the southern ocean, Phaeocystis antarctica is most common. And in the Mediterranean, we find that Phaeocystis cordata and Phaeocystis shani is common, but these groups can also be common in the Indian Ocean and also in the Pacific, especially at low latitudes. So interestingly, this same study showed that acantharians will host the dominant Phaeocystis species in a region as their dominant symbiont. So if you collect an acantharian from the Southern Ocean, it's most likely to have Phaeocystis antarctica as its symbiont. And if you collect an acantharian from the Mediterranean, it's most likely to have Phaeocystis cordata as its symbiont. But intra-host symbiont diversity had not previously been looked at. And intra-host symbiont diversity can actually tell us a whole lot. So If symbionts within each host are all genetically the same, this would indicate that there's a single uptake event and symbiont division is probably happening within hosts. Conversely, if symbionts within hosts are genetically diverse, this would indicate that there's multiple uptake events and would suggest that symbionts might not be able to divide inside of the hosts. Furthermore, if the symbiont diversity is a direct reflection of environmental availability of symbionts, the host could be continuously picking up new symbionts, and these could be a random sampling of what's available to them. On the other side, if intra-host and environmental symbiont communities are different, this would be evidence that the symbionts are being maintained inside of the host, or there's some selectivity of symbionts, so it's not a random sampling of the available symbionts. So in order to test this, I looked at 42 individual acantharians that were mostly collected from the cruise stations from this cruise track, but I also collected some additional cells from near Okinawa Island and from Catalina, near Catalina Island in California. And then I compared the intra-host symbiont communities within the cruise samples to the seawater from the cruise samples, specifically looking at the 0.2 micrometer pore size filter, which should have those free-living Phaeocystis cells since the hosts have already been filtered out. So looking at the results, the intra-host symbiont diversity, each bar here is one individual acantharian host, and then they're grouped into the location where I collected them from, with the cruise samples on the left, and then the Okinawa Island samples and the Catalina Island samples. And you can see right away that each individual acantharian hosts multiple symbiont genotypes. In fact, there's 3 to 12 unique symbiont sequence variants inside of each host. Another interesting thing to point out here is that chrysochromolina, this green color, which is very abundant in the Catalina samples, was not previously found as a symbiont of the clade F acantharians, although it has been found in other acantharian clades before. And in addition, these gray parts of the bars are Phaeocystis jani, and Phaeocystis jani also previously hadn't been reported as a symbiont in acantharians. So comparing this now to the environmental samples, we can see that the relative abundance of symbionts in the surrounding seawater is not exactly the same as the relative abundance of symbionts inside of the hosts. So the chrysochromolina are quite abundant outside of the host, but they were only picked up by a couple symbionts in Okinawa and in the Western North Pacific. Whereas the Phaeocystis cordata in this pink color, these are quite common inside of the hosts, but they're not actually that common outside of the hosts. In addition, there's multiple sequence variants that were found inside of hosts, but were not found in any external samples. So all of these symbiont variants with the asterisks, so 2, 5, 7, 11, 13, 14, 15, 16, 18, and 19, were all found inside of hosts, but were never found in the surrounding environment. So we can also look at these results as a principal coordinates analysis, and we can clearly see that the blue samples that are host-associated cluster separately from the black samples that are environmental. And these results were statistically significant. So in summary, we have genetically diverse symbionts within hosts. We have, which is indicative of multiple uptake events, suggesting that symbionts do not divide within hosts. And we have distinct intra-host and environmental symbiont communities, which is evidence for symbiont maintenance or selectivity of symbionts. So to look at this a little bit more, I did some lysotracker green staining with acantharians. So lysotracker green is a fluorescent dye that selectively stains acidic compartments within the cell. So any organelles that are involved with digestion. And I wanted to see if the symbionts were inside of vacuoles that were acidic. And what I found is you can see that the symbionts are not inside of acidic compartments. They're not inside of green compartments. And these smaller green compartments, these are lysosomes, and these are not necessarily concentrated around symbionts. So this is some evidence that hosts are not systematically digesting their symbionts, and there's probably some extended symbiont maintenance. But if hosts are not digesting symbionts, the question arises as to how they are actually controlling symbiont populations. How do they avoid symbiont overgrowth? Which leads us right into chapter three. So chapter three looks at nutrient exchange and host control in Acantharea-Phaeocystis photosymbioses. So a major problem for all organisms that host endosymbionts is how to prevent overgrowth. They want to keep their symbionts happy and productive, but not too happy, where the symbionts are able to take control and overgrow the hosts. So hosts can manage symbiont populations in a number of ways. They could digest their excess symbionts, they could release excess symbionts, or they could limit symbiont division. We've already seen in the last chapter that it doesn't seem like symbionts are being digested inside of the acantharians. We also haven't seen acantharians releasing excess symbionts. So this doesn't mean that they're not, it just means we haven't caught them, and other rhizarians do release excess symbionts. So this leaves us with the possibility that they're limiting symbiont division. And so in order to look into this, in order to investigate this, I wanted to look into the physiological state of the symbionts while they're inside of the host compared to the physiological state of symbionts when they're outside of the host. And in order to do this, I used RNA-seq to compare gene expression within hosts to Phaeocystis gene expression when they're living outside of hosts. So I prepared RNA-seq libraries from 16 individual acantharians. And you remember now that the acantharians have diverse symbiont communities. So a problem arises trying to think about which Phaeocystis species to make RNA libraries from in order to compare that gene expression between the free living and the symbiotic state. And you might notice that there's lots of blue in all of these samples, but unfortunately, all of these blue sequence variants belong to the Phao2 clade, which is not a cultured clade, so those are off the table. And that leaves me with Phaeocystis cordata, which is this nice pink color, and Phaeocystis shani, which is the gray color. So I prepared culture replicates from three replicates for Phaeocystis cordata and three replicates for Phaeocystis shani, and I extracted RNA from these replicates and then did RNA-seq library preparation following the exact same methods that I had used for the acantharian holobionts. There is a problem though. So there's a fundamental difference between Phaeocystis cordata and Phaeocystis shani. So Phaeocystis shani forms colonies in cultures and presumably in the wild, and Phaeocystis cordata does not. So these images come from the original paper that described these species. And you can see for Phaeocystis shani, they make these kind of loose, disorganized colonies, which are different than a lot of other species of Phaeocystis. But if you look at this electron micrograph, you can see that there is this polysaccharide matrix around the Phaeocystis shani cells, which is in stark comparison for Phaeocystis cordata, which never makes colonies and is a very active swimmer. So in this image, the flagella are moving so quickly that you cannot see them. And these cells swim so actively that they can keep themselves from sedimenting in culture vessels. So inherently, this comparison between cultured Phaeocystis shani and symbiotic Phaeocystis shani and cultured Phaeocystis cordata and symbiotic Phaeocystis cordata is not the same comparison, because this colony formation is really going to complicate that comparison. But still, I wanted to look for similarities between these two species, because they are so different. If two things that are happening in both of these species in symbiosis pop up in the results, then that would be a nice evidence that those processes are really important to symbiosis. So I did differential gene expression for both species, and I found that looking at these principal component analyses, for both species, the gene expression data clusters separately for the symbiotic samples, which are in gray, and the free-living samples, which are in blue. So even though Phaeocystis shani is making colonies, the free-living samples still cluster separately from the symbiotic samples. And for both species, there was more genes that were significantly downregulated than there were genes that were significantly upregulated. But there is more genes significantly upregulated in Phaeocystis chordata than in Phaeocystis shani, which maybe has something to do with colony formation. So then looking at the function of all of these genes, I did gene function enrichment testing, looking at GO terms and KEG pathways, and I found that in symbiosis, DNA replication and cell cycle progression, as well as biosynthesis of macromolecules, is enriched among downregulated genes for both species. And photosynthesis and gene expression was enriched among upregulated genes for both species. So moving forward, I'm going to focus primarily on Phaeocystis chordata as I dive into these results a little deeper. First, for time, just looking at one species will certainly get us to the end of this presentation, but also because that comparison between those flagellated cells and the symbiotic cells is a much more straightforward comparison. The colonies kind of complicate things. So looking at the DNA replication complex, in this figure, any subunit that is red has the gene for that subunit downregulated in symbiosis. None of these are red because they're not, or sorry, upregulated in symbiosis, but none of these are red. And then if it's blue, the gene for that subunit is downregulated in symbiosis. And if it's gray, it's not differentially expressed. And if it's white, I wasn't able to annotate the gene for that subunit. So you can see, I think, pretty clearly that all of these subunits are downregulated in symbiosis. They're all blue, which gives us some indication that DNA synthesis and replication is slowed or not happening in symbiotic Phaeocystis. And then looking at the cell cycle pathway, same thing. If it's blue, it is downregulated. If it's gray, it is not differentially expressed. And if it's white, it wasn't annotated. And we can see that for the genes that were differentially expressed, they were all downregulated in symbiosis. And some important genes are downregulated here. So we have cyclin genes, cyclin-dependent kinase genes, and anaphase-promoting complex genes. So we have genes that are in all the different phases of the cell cycle are downregulated in symbiosis. And this progression through the cell cycle is actually transcriptionally controlled. So this downregulation is good evidence that the cell cycle pathway that cell cycle progression is either slowed or paused in symbiosis. So if we look at these results for DNA replication and cell cycle, alongside the fact that the cells are getting much bigger in symbiosis, we can see that Phaeocystis cell division is blocked in symbiosis. But the cell's not just getting bigger. The cell also has a lot more chloroplasts. And this is really interesting because in single-celled algae, usually chloroplast division is tightly coupled with cell division. So if the cell divides, the chloroplasts divide. So that a daughter cell has the same number of chloroplasts as the mother cell did, or the parent cell. And this is transcriptionally controlled that these things happen at the same time. So I looked at the nuclear encoded genes for plastid division, and I found that in symbiosis, these genes are expressed at the same level, or in some cases even higher than they were in the free living cells. So this is telling us that the cell division is becoming decoupled from the chloroplast division. The chloroplasts are dividing, even though the cells are not dividing, and now chloroplasts are accumulating inside of the cell. So of course we want to know how this is happening. How is the acantharian stopping the symbiont from dividing? And symbiotic hosts can limit symbiont population in a number of ways, and one common way is to regulate access to nitrogen and phosphorus. And there are some nice indicator genes for phosphorus limitation and nitrogen limitation. So the alkaline phosphatases, if they are upregulated, are an indication of phosphorus limitation. And nitrate-nitrite transporter, if that is upregulated, that is an indication of nitrogen limitation. So first looking at the alkaline phosphatase genes, I found that in symbiosis, these genes are not expressed at a level that I can detect, even though they are expressed in the free living cells, which were in culture conditions that had plenty of nutrients for them. So this tells us that probably the symbionts are not phosphorus limited. And then looking at the nitrogen genes, the nitrate-nitrite transporter is downregulated in symbiosis, which is an indication that the symbionts are not nitrogen limited. But if we follow the nitrogen metabolism pathway a little bit further, we see that the genes that are associated with ammonia assimilation are upregulated in symbiosis. So this is an indication that the host might be providing ammonium to the symbionts as a nitrogen source, or providing some other nitrogen compound that's easily broken down to ammonium, such as urea. So far we've seen that symbiotic phaeocystis is not nutrient limited, and that hosts are providing symbionts with ammonium or some other compound that can be broken down to ammonium. And this makes it seem as though the hosts are using a nutrient-independent mechanism to control the symbionts, which gives them finer control over their symbionts because the control cannot be relieved by exogenous nutrient sources. And this also makes sure that the symbionts continue producing at a very high rate. And indeed, if we look at photosynthesis and carbon fixation pathways, we do see that these are upregulated in symbiosis. So if we look at the genes for photosystems, the electron transport chain and ATP synthase, subunits for these complexes are upregulated in symbiosis. The majority of enzymes in the Calvin-Benson cycle for carbon fixation are upregulated in symbiosis. And then coming over to glycolysis and gluconeogenesis, we see that the part of the pathway that takes substrate from the Calvin-Benson cycle and then moves it through to the pentose phosphate pathway are all upregulated in symbiosis. But if we look at the part of the glycolysis pathway that happens outside of the chloroplast, that produces pyruvate that can then be sent to the Krebs cycle and the electron transport chain, these parts of the carbon metabolism pathway are downregulated in symbiosis. So even though the symbionts are potentially photosynthesizing more and fixing more carbon, it doesn't seem like they're using that carbon directly through carbon metabolism. So instead, they might be sending that carbon over to the pentose phosphate pathway, which then goes to nucleotide and amino acid synthesis. And they could be sharing these substrates with the host, either as 5-carbon sugars from the pentose phosphate pathway or as these other compounds, as nucleotides and amino acids. So in summary for this chapter, phaeocystis cell division is blocked in symbiosis. The hosts are providing ample nutrients to enhance symbiont photosynthesis, carbon fixation, and presumably carbon export. And phaeocystis is being transformed into a photosynthetic machine in symbiosis. And together, these things tell us that there's a high level of symbiont integration and host control in symbiosis. So instead of letting symbionts do as they please and run amok and maybe even take over hosts, the hosts are very carefully, finely controlling symbionts and manipulating their symbiont garden. So moving on to conclusions for this whole thesis. First, photosymbiotic acantharians are abundant in low nutrient subtropical regions. They are concentrated near the sea surface, making them important primary producers and potentially showing us niche partitioning. Second, acantharians collect symbionts more than once and maintain them throughout their life cycle, showing us that symbionts probably are not able to divide inside of hosts. And then finally, these acantharians are hijacking these phaeocystis cells and converting them into photosynthetic energy machines, indicating there's a high degree of symbiont integration and host control even before some of the more understood steps of plastid acquisition. So with that, I would like to say thank you to a whole lot of people. First, the examiners that are taking time out to watch this presentation and talk to me afterwards, and everybody that took time out of their day to watch this presentation. I'd have to thank Satoshi, who's my thesis advisor, Sasha Mikheyev, who was my rotation advisor for 2 rotations and is on my thesis committee. Mary Grossman was the postdoc in the lab when I first joined, and she helped me come up with most of my thesis proposal. And I would like to thank everybody in the Meteori lab, past and present, but especially a few people that have been really helpful throughout specific phases of my thesis, and a whole lot of people from the Ecology and Evolution lab, including people that have helped me with molecular techniques and some more on the computing side. And from the scientific community, Dave Karen and his lab members, Lisa Messerup and Sarah Hu, let me come visit them and help me with sampling and figuring out how to get RNA out of individual acantharians. Carla came all the way here to Okinawa for my thesis proposal exam. Johan has also let me visit his lab and has been very patient in talking to me and helping me work through all of this data that I collected for chapter 3. And Emmanuel and Boston were my master's thesis advisors, and they have continued to be extremely supportive and helpful throughout this degree as well. And there's many people from the OIS sections that have helped enormously with sequencing and imaging and collecting samples. From Jamstek, everybody on the ship, and especially Hiromi Watanabe and Dugo Lindsay. And then this thesis was funded by OIST and the JSPS, Japan Society for the Promotion of Science. I have to thank my family, my mom, all of the TAFs, all of the Brisbans, and last but not least, my husband Jamie and my Nasher. So with that, I would like to take any questions that anybody has for me. I think that you can raise your hand somehow, and then the coordinator that's helping in this room here will let you turn on your microphone and ask your question.
Thank you very much.
Lisa, could you change me to the host? I'm fine.
Okay, the
Yes, hello, Maggie. Yes, can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Okay.
Great. Well, this is Anne McElroy from New York. Maggie, first, thank you for inviting me to this amazing presentation. I am so proud to be associated with even a small part of your education. I really liked your combination of sort of basic oceanography and really detailed molecular analysis. And unlike so many molecular talks I hear, you really tied yourself to function and even evolution. And brava, just amazing job. Congratulations.
Thanks.
Okay, it's already muted. Okay, the next is Jackie Collier. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Great. I see I'm not the only one in New York up joining you this morning. Maggie, that was great. Really tremendous work. And I have a question for you. I'm wondering whether your single cell metatranscriptomes also revealed the presence of multiple different types of endosymbionts in each acantharian cell, if you dug into that at all.
Yeah, so I only did that a little bit. So I mapped reads from those kind of metatranscriptomes to different Phaeocystis transcriptomes to see what proportion of reads were coming from each each host to each different type of symbiont. But there's not a ton of Phaeocystis transcriptomes available. So I was only able to do that for a couple different Phaeocystis strains. And when I did do that, I was able to see that there, from the transcriptome data too, that there was different strains inside of the host. So when I was looking at the two different species, I only let reads map to one species. They weren't allowed to map to multiple, so there wasn't double counting of any of the symbiont reads. But I haven't gone deeper in like looking at an entire database and seeing what type of sequences I could find in addition to Phaeocystis as transcripts.
Cool, thanks.
Is there any questions? I guess. Can we get one? Okay. Yeah, Joshua Queen.
Yeah, Maggie, really great job. Question on your RNA work. you see any changes in transcripts related to ferritin or things that are associated with iron or metal storage in your symbionts?
He's muted.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah, now we can.
Oh, okay, cool. No, sorry. My question was, well, first off, really great job. When you were looking at your Phaeocystis transcriptomes, did you see any changes in expression related to things like ferritin or metal storage protein expression?
That's a really good question. I haven't dived into that yet. So I have been pretty much kind of following one pathway to the next, and I haven't made it quite that far yet.
Cool, thanks.
Sorry.
No worries.
No more questions? Okay, if there are no more questions, I'd like to close the public part of the event. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much for coming. Hope to see you in real life someday.